Thank you all for coming tonight. I'm Donna Boynton from the marketing department. I spoke with many of you over the phone, and I'm glad to see that you all came out this evening. This is the third and final lecture in our fall lecture series. We offer our lecture series twice a year to help you keep on top of your health, to update you on the latest health news, and more importantly, introduce you to the resources and the people that we have here at Milford Regional to help you. One of those people is Dr. Jeffrey Steinberg. Dr. Steinberg is a urologist, and he's been on staff for about a year now with us. Dr. Steinberg is based in Hopedale, and as of January 1st, he'll be opening his own practice called Urology Specialist of Milford, and that will be in Hopedale as well. Now I introduce you to Dr. Steinberg.
Thank you, Donna. I appreciate it. And thanks to the marketing department here at Milford Regional for hosting this event tonight. We're blessed to have fairly nice weather here as we get into the late fall season. And we're also blessed that the election is over now, so we can actually get back to taking care of our health and some other things. And there's lots of questions on the horizon about what's going to happen with Obamacare and health insurance and the exchanges. And I'm not going to talk about any of that tonight. I'm going to talk more about prostate cancer and some common conditions that men have, because this is a very complicated topic. If you Google prostate cancer, there's probably over 2 million references on the internet, and it can be overwhelming if you have a loved one with prostate cancer, or you yourself are diagnosed with prostate cancer. There's almost too much information. So my approach as a urologist for the past 25 years is to try to really individualize the decision about looking for prostate cancer in a particular patient, and then if prostate cancer is detected, the decision on what the best treatment is. And that treatment may include no treatment, or what we call active surveillance. So just to tell you a little bit about myself, I've been practicing urology for 25 years. I was raised in Philadelphia, so I am an Eagles and Phillies fan, and you know, it hasn't been so great lately for us, but my wife was raised here in Boston, so you know, remember the Sixers and the Celtics rivalry in the old days? We got into some pretty good discussions about that, but you know, New England sports has really dominated recently. I went to school in Philadelphia, but then after I graduated from medical school at Temple University, I then came up to the Harvard program in urology and trained there. So a urologist is a surgeon who specializes in diseases of the urinary tract. So that's both the reproductive issues as well as urinary issues and things like infertility, kidney stones, etc. And it's hard to go through life actually without needing to see urologists at one time or another, whether you're a man or a woman, because these are very, very common problems. The nice thing about urology is that many of these issues are quality of life issues that we deal with, things like incontinence or leakage of urine, infertility or difficulty conceiving a child, erectile dysfunction in men, things that we can improve very easily. And we get a lot of satisfaction out of doing that, and we create a good relationship with our patients. We also deal with life-threatening things, and those life-threatening things come in the form of different sorts of cancers of the urinary tract. The largest incidence of cancer in the urinary tract is, of course, the prostate cancer, and that's what we're here to talk about tonight. We also deal with patients with bladder cancer, kidney cancer, testicular cancer, and adrenal cancer, and some other rare cancers. So we do deal with a lot of quality of life issues, but we also work closely with other doctors, such as radiation oncologists and medical oncologists, in giving a holistic approach to patients who are newly diagnosed with cancer. So I'd like to talk a little bit about this kind of the state of the art in 2016 regarding prostate cancer. And the title of the talk is "You Have Prostate Cancer, Now What?" is very apropos, because oftentimes when men get that diagnosis, they sort of are at a loss for what to do next. So it's a very, very confusing condition. So what is the prostate? Well, other than keeping urologists very busy. The prostate is a reproductive organ at the base of the bladder through which urine travels through the urethra. When you're in your 20s, it's about 20 cc's, or a little bit larger than a large grape or small plum. And as you get older, it grows about 10 cc's per decade. So what is the function of the prostate? The prostate makes fluid that goes into the man's semen to support sperm. It has a reproductive role. After a man's reproductive years, it basically only causes trouble. And usually the trouble it causes is prostate enlargement, so that it'll enlarge enlarge and narrow down the urethral channel. The typical symptoms are getting up at night to urinate, urinating frequently, sense of not completely emptying your bladder. Those are the typical symptoms. And that's called benign prostate hyperplasia. And all men have that as they get older to some degree or other. The other condition, of course, is prostate cancer. The thing about prostate cancer is rarely in the early stages we have any of those symptoms. Getting up at night, that's usually not a symptom of prostate cancer. Going to the bathroom frequently during the day, that's generally not a symptom of prostate cancer. And just having to take longer to empty your bladder, again, that's usually due to benign prostate enlargement. So that's a very, very common condition that all men will experience to some degree as they get older. So overview of prostate cancer, well, it's a very, very common disease. So 1 in 6 men in the United States will be diagnosed with prostate cancer. Second most common non-skin cancer in America in men. Number one still being, anybody know what the number one cancer is? Was it? No? Lung cancer. Lung cancer is still the most common cancer, both in men and women, in the United States. And much more, has much more morbidity and mortality than prostate cancer. Every 3 minutes, a man is diagnosed with prostate cancer in the United States. Now, if you have a brother or a father or even a son who's been diagnosed with prostate cancer, your risk of getting prostate cancer actually increases to 1 in 4. If you have 2 first-degree relatives, say you have 2 brothers that are diagnosed with prostate cancer, your risk is 1 in 3. Of developing prostate cancer. But that's a question I always get, colon cancer. Doctor, I just had my colonoscopy and everything was fine. Do I need to have my prostate checked? Yes. Why is that? Because when you do a colonoscopy, you can't see the prostate. The prostate is on the other side of the rectum. So here's the rectum. The colonoscope goes up into the colon, and you never actually see the prostate. And the GI doctor, gastroenterologist, doesn't feel the prostate. You still need to have your prostate checked and the PSA test. And we'll talk a little bit about the PSA, prostate-specific antigen. So second leading cause of death in cancer in men, 32,000 deaths in 2014. Your lifetime risk of dying is a little bit under 3%. And there have been a lot of famous people who have had diagnosed with prostate cancer early and cured, and some not so early. So most recently, I think there was a lot of publicity around Ben Stiller, right? And it was secret for a while. He was treated, he had his prostate out, he did great. And then he came out and said, you know, I was diagnosed early and I was cured. And I think that created a nice awareness in the general community. Then there's some patients who were diagnosed late. Does anybody know who this is? Frank Zappa died of metastatic prostate cancer at a fairly young age. So what are the 2 tests we use to diagnose prostate cancer? Well, one is the digital rectal examination, and that has nothing to do with computers. This is the old-fashioned digit. I had a guy in here. I said, I examined your prostate. I said, your prostate feels enlarged. He said, I want a second opinion, so I used 2 fingers. But I don't recommend that. And then this other test is the PSA, prostate-specific antigen. So there's been a lot of controversy about prostate-specific antigens. Should I get my PSA checked? There's a lot of false readings for prostate-specific antigen. And actually, there was a big panel called the U.S. Preventive Health Services Task Force several years ago that said, you know what? we're looking to look at all these tests like colonoscopy and mammograms and PSAs, and we're giving PSA a grade D, failing grade to them, recommendation. We don't recommend PSA. And there was this big uproar from the professional societies, cancer doctors, urologists, who said, you know what? We don't agree with this. We think that the studies that you did were flawed. So all the different organizations came out with different recommendations, and I'm going to talk about a little bit about recommendations for whether you should have a PSA or not. But it created a huge controversy. And what we saw as urologists, because we're kind of at the tail end of this, the primary care doctors are typically the ones to do these tests, is a significant decrease in men being referred for an elevated PSA. And what we're starting to see is patients being diagnosed with later stage prostate cancer. So it's a very, very controversial topic, and there's still tremendous disagreement amongst physicians and amongst public health entities about who should be checked for prostate cancer, at what age, how frequently, and what do you do with an abnormal number. But luckily, there are new technologies that are available, and I'll talk a little bit about those to help sort those questions out. So what are the symptoms of prostate cancer? And I put this little schematic up here to show that prostate cancer usually occurs in the outside, if think of it as an apple, and the core of the apple is where the urine is. So the cancer typically develops in the outside portion of this apple, not in the core. So early on, because the cancer occurs in the outside, it doesn't interfere with the urinary channel. There's no difficulty urinating. There's no blood in the urine. There are none of those symptoms. So early on, there are no symptoms of prostate cancer. When you do start to have symptoms, that is pelvic pain, poor appetite, pain possibly in other areas of your body, in the bones, that can be a sign of advanced prostate cancer. So our goal as urologists is to catch these cancers early while they're still confined to the prostate, and if appropriate, meaning, and that sounds funny, if appropriate, but if appropriate, to treat them, to cure them in the early stages. So this is how prostate cancer starts off. It starts off as small areas within the prostate, in the periphery, and if it's on the outside part of the prostate, on the back portion of the prostate, when we do a prostate exam, we might feel a little firm area, a nodule, or one side might be elevated compared to the other side, or might feel a little firm. There can be very subtle changes. But the unfortunate part is, with a digital rectal examination, we can only feel about 40% of the surface area of the prostate. The rest of it is really not accessible to the examining finger. So there can be prostate and cancer in what we call the anterior portion or the transitional zone of the prostate, areas that we cannot feel with the examining finger. So this is the American Urological Association. So this is the organization that I and most 10,000 urologists in the United States belong to. And we've taken all the evidence and tried to distill this down, and we made these general recommendations. And I want to say that there's a caveat here. Not all of the other medical societies agree with these recommendations. But because we're the ones who deal with prostate cancer patients, and we've looked at the data, this is what a large panel of urologists came up with about 2 years ago from the American Urological Association. So the whole question is about decision to look for prostate cancer. So if somebody is less than 55 years and has a high risk, that is African American or family history, then there's an individualized decision regarding prostate cancer screening, meaning you sit down and talk with the man and perhaps their significant other about, would you like to be tested for prostate cancer? Here is the risk of having an elevated PSA and not having prostate cancer. You might have an elevated PSA. I'll send you to a urologist if that's the case. You might have a biopsy. The biopsy might not show cancer. You might bleed from the biopsy. You might get sick from the biopsy. You can get what's called sepsis, or an infection that goes in the bloodstream. And it causes a lot of anxiety to have a prostate biopsy. So those are the problems with having a falsely elevated PSA. On the flip side, there are problems with a low PSA. That doesn't necessarily mean that you don't have prostate cancer. Because we used to say that PSAs are normal between 0 and 4. That's not true anymore. We've done a lot of other studies to show that a PSA can go up with age, usually about 0.35 per year. But it's not just the absolute number. It's how high is it for your age, for your ethnicity, whether you're African American or Caucasian, and also what is the velocity or the rate of rise of your PSA year to year? Those are all important factors to decide whether other investigations should be done. So it's not just 0 to 4 is normal. It's not like your cholesterol is less than 180. That seems pretty good. This is very complicated. It has to be looked at the context of who you're testing and what your prior PSAs were. Between 55 and 69 years old, there's this shared decision making that is, okay, you're healthy, you have no family members with prostate cancer, you're not African American. If we found prostate cancer and you're otherwise healthy, would you want to know about it? Number one, would you want to be treated? Number two. So somebody who comes in and is 69 years old and has heart disease and diabetes and may have had a stroke, you have to kind of look at the person as a whole and say, if we found a small amount of prostate cancer in you, sir, with all your other medical issues, would we actually look for it and do a biopsy? And if we found it, would it impact your survival? So that's what we call shared decision making, or trying to look at the patient as an individual and decide whether that test should be done. Because if you have all those other risk factors, the odds are if you find prostate cancer at the age of 69 and you have heart disease and diabetes and you've had a stroke, you're not going to die of prostate cancer. Still in the United States, 9 out of 10 men are dying of cardiovascular disease, a heart attack or a stroke. And every 2 years, we used to say every 1 year, but every 2 years may be appropriate for men to get their PSA tested if they decide to do it. And men who are in excellent health, and greater than the age of 70, may benefit from screening. Now, the U.S. Preventive Health Services Task Force said no screening, absolutely no testing over the age of 70. Well, I have a lot of guys who are over 70. They're in great health. They're on no medications. They exercise every day. They have greater than a 10-year life expectancy. And you know what? If we found prostate cancer in those men, they probably would want to be treated because if we let prostate cancer go and they're otherwise healthy, that could be the cause of their death. So that's the complicated thing about this. You really can't make blanket recommendations now. You have to look at a certain context of the man's overall health, their risk factors, and their desires about detecting prostate cancer. And then if we do find it, about treating it. So it's become a lot more muddy since 10 years ago. So what do we do if we get past the point of saying we're going to look for prostate cancer? We do a prostate biopsy. And the way we do that is with this ultrasound probe. It's usually done in the office. Usually we give a little bit of a sedative like Valium. And then we put Novocaine in through this transducer, this ultrasound transducer, around the prostate to numb the nerves. And then we take samples of the prostate. And typically this would take about 20 minutes in a physician's office. We take at least 12 samples of the prostate. Some experts say we need to take more to adequately sample the prostate. And the samples are like a hair. They're a tiny piece of tissue. And those are sent to a pathologist who then looks at the tissue under the microscope to see if there is prostate cancer. So this is typically how prostate biopsy is done. For some men who would desire it, we can also do these under anesthesia. It's sort of like a colonoscopy. It's under twilight or sedation, and they have no pain and feel just fine afterwards. And the majority of men tolerate this very well, just doing it with Novocaine and a little Valium in the office. So what do we see under the microscope when we see prostate cancer? So this is kind of a schematic, and these are the actual slides. They're a little hard to see, but they're also reproduced in some of the materials up here. This is called the Gleason grading system. And this is named after a pathologist who worked for the Armed Forces Institute of Pathology, who came up with this grading system. And the grading system basically goes from 1 to 5, 1 being the least aggressive, and 5 being the most aggressive type of prostate cancer, depending on how abnormal the cells look. So these cells, this is what a normal cell kind of looks like, nice and round and has a nucleus, if any of you have taken biology, you remember that? And these grade 5 cells, they don't look anything like a normal cell. And this grading system has been universally adopted throughout the world and is very reproducible. Pathologists easily agree on what is a grade 1, what is a grade 2, what is a grade 3. And then we take the two grades and we take the most common type of cell we see and the second most common type of cell we see, and we come up with a score. And the Gleason scores range from 2 to 10. So if we see that everything is a grade 1, we add 1 plus 1 and we get a score of 2. The maximum would all be grade 5. We see every single cell is grade 5, so we add 5 plus 5, and that's 10. I've never seen a grade 2. I've a couple times seen a grade 10. Usually we're getting scores like grade 3 plus 4 for 7. That's probably the most common biopsy result, and that's the Gleason grading system. And it's a very important factor when we're trying to decide what to do in terms of treatment or whether we can do what's called active surveillance. So a Gleason score of 6 or lower means the cancer is, quote, low grade. You say, hey, 6 doesn't sound so good. 6 is closer to 10 than it is to 1. But 6 actually is a medium grade cancer, or low grade cancer, and is more appropriate perhaps for active surveillance, watching and waiting actively, doing surveillance to see what happens. A Gleason score of 7 means the cancer is medium grade, and this is the grade that we most commonly see. And it could either be 3 plus 4, meaning there's more grade 3 than 4, or grade 4 plus 3. And that doesn't sound like a big difference, but it is. So if we see more of a grade 4 cell than we do a grade 3 cell, that's a more aggressive tumor grade, and we treat those differently. So all the subtleties that go into making a decision are very, very important when we're trying to decide what the right treatment is for prostate cancer. Now, a score of 8, 9, or 10 is what we call poorly differentiated or high grade, and we almost universally will treat those cancers because they are aggressive, have a higher chance of going outside the prostate and going to other areas in the body. Now, the good thing about prostate cancer is that even in late stages, when the cancer's gone outside the prostate, it can go to the bones, it can go to the lymph nodes, it can go to other areas of the body. It's still treatable. It's very treatable by giving hormone treatments, and we're blessed to be partnering with the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute here. They have a whole cadre of oncologists and medical oncologists who have up-to-date treatments for high-stage prostate cancer. So we're blessed to have that right here in our community to help us with those treatments. In order to understand that, we need to talk about staging. So what we just talked about was grading, the Gleason grading system, how it looks under the microscope. And then we have staging, and there's various staging systems, and this is a little bit dated, but T1 is basically something that we won't feel on rectal examination. We usually find these by elevated PSAs. We go and do a biopsy. We wouldn't have known it was there unless the PSA was elevated. Confined to the prostate, T2 is, you can feel this. This is indenting the prostate. So on a rectal examination, you would be able to feel this. And it's usually involving more than half of the prostate. T3 means it's going into other organs. These little rabbit ears here are called the seminal vesicles. They're also important in reproduction. But they're one of the areas prostate cancer likes to spread to, and if we detect that the cancer has gone outside the prostate into the seminal vesicles or into the bladder neck or even approaching the side of the pelvis, it's a stage 3. And a stage 4 is very, very bulky disease, meaning there's a lot of cancer in the pelvis. And then we look at whether it's spread to the lymph nodes or other areas in the body by doing other x-rays. And these are two very, very important examinations, which once prostate cancer is diagnosed, we might advise. This is called multiparametric MRI, and this is a very, very common procedure to, number one, look for cancers that would otherwise be missed with just ultrasound. But number two, after prostate cancer is diagnosed, to see whether it's actually going outside the prostate or perhaps invading the seminal vesicles or the percentage of the prostate that might be involved. Because on many MRI tests, it will show up as a very, very discreet nodule that we wouldn't otherwise feel or even see on an ultrasound. So this is a technology that is fairly widespread now. It is coming here to Milford Regional Medical Center. We have an MRI machine. This requires special software and special training. So multiparametric MRI is a technology that will be coming here in the near future. And then bone scan is a nuclear scan, a nuclear test, where you get an injection of a nuclear tracer. It's not a significant amount of nuclear tracer. And then you're basically put under a Geiger counter to see if the cancer has spread to the bones. And this is a very, very sensitive test for detecting whether prostate cancer has gone into any of the bones. And it doesn't always correlate with how you feel. You could feel just fine, but have a very aggressive prostate cancer, have no pain anywhere, and sometimes we'll find a positive bone scan. And that will dictate how we treat a patient. So these are two of many types of staging tests we use to determine what the appropriate treatment for prostate cancer is. One very, very important technology that has been developed over the past year is something called MRI ultrasound fusion biopsies. So when we do an ultrasound in the office and look at the prostate and we're looking for cancer, the problem is we rarely see something on an ultrasound image that looks like cancer. The whole prostate looks the same. It looks like a very bland field of tissue. And it's not unusual for urologists to do 3, 4, 5 biopsies on a man as the PSA continues to rise and still not find the cancer. And that's a very common scenario. So recently we've adopted this MRI where we will send a man to the MRI facility. They'll have this multiparametric MRI. Then we'll take these images produced by the MRI and we'll fuse them in a machine called an MRI ultrasound fusion platform with the actual ultrasound biopsies. And simultaneously, while we're looking at the MRI, we can then circumscribe the area on the ultrasound and then take biopsies that are computer-driven to target the area that is suspicious for prostate cancer that we might not otherwise hit. So this is a very, very helpful technology in finding prostate cancer in men who we have not been able to find it in traditional ultrasound-guided biopsies. And this is another technology which will soon be coming to Milford Regional Medical Center. I'd like to introduce Tom McMahon, who's here from Urolase. He is a local rep, and we're going to show a short video after this about MRI ultrasound fusion. But it's been a very, very important tool for urologists to help us find those hard-to-find cancers that we know in our guts are there, but we have not been able to detect them on a routine biopsy. It's also helpful for using these images in other treatments that I'll talk about, the MRI in guiding us when we're only going to treat part of the prostate, and that's becoming more popular in today's technology of just treating where the cancer is. Another controversial topic. So what are the prostate cancer, and this goes to this gentleman's question, the prostate cancer risk groups. So The American Urological and the National Cancer Institute and NCCN have come up with these guidelines of what are low risk, intermediate, or what we call medium risk and high risk groups for prostate cancer. So low risk cancer are PSA levels that are less than 10, Gleason scores of 6 or lower, and stages of T1 or T2. Medium risk has PSA levels of 10 to 20, Gleason scores of 7, or stages above T2B would mean more than half of the prostates involved. And then high risk, PSA levels of greater than 20, Gleason scores of 8 or higher, and stages of T2C. So we're using both the Gleason's grade, the clinical stage, or how far it's gone outside the prostate, and the PSA levels, all three factors, to determine whether it's something low, medium, or high-grade cancer, or high-risk cancer. What if you're diagnosed with prostate cancer, and we used to call this watchful waiting, and that connoted that it was a passive approach to prostate cancer. We're going to see what happens. You know, if I feel well, I won't go back to the doctor. If I don't feel well, then I will go back to the doctor. But now we're doing what's called active surveillance. That means we're doing something. And we're doing something collaboratively with the physician about prostate cancer. So how do we do this if you're diagnosed with prostate cancer? Well, we do checkups, basically a digital rectal examination with the doctor. We repeat the PSA at certain intervals. We may repeat the biopsies. It may be annually we repeat the biopsies. Even if the PSA hasn't changed, your doctor might recommend doing a biopsy every year because they want to see if the grade of the tumor has changed or the volume of the tumor has changed. And a change then may lead to intervention. So this is part of the complexity of prostate cancer. There are many men who are diagnosed with prostate cancer. My own father was diagnosed with prostate cancer at the age of 60. He had one focus of grade 6 prostate cancer, and he opted, although his son is a urologist, he opted to say, I'm not going to do anything about it. And, you know, I was concerned about that. I mean, it caused a lot of discussion. But he said, you know what? I'm not going to do anything about it. But I'm going to my urologist to get it checked on at least an annual basis. And he had multiple repeat biopsies. And he never had more than that one biopsy of Gleason grade 6 prostate cancer. And his PSA never got above 2. It was very low. And he died several years ago at the age of 80 from lung cancer. Was never a smoker. Was never exposed to other carcinogens that we know of. So he made the right choice. But he made an informed choice because he had a low-grade cancer. He had a small volume of cancer and a very low PSA. So that the prostate cancer over the 20 years since he was diagnosed never affected his quality of life or his duration of life. So that's why this active surveillance is becoming a much more popular option, but it has to be a collaborative option between the patient, their family, and the physician. They agree they're going to stick to this regimen of following the prostate cancer in an active way. So what if we do our diagnosis of prostate cancer? We're going to get into some of the treatments here. So we're blessed, as I said, to have Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, and we have Dr. Oreo in the back, who is our chief of radiation oncology, who does external beam irradiation therapy. And this is, and Dr. Phillips back there. That's all right. I saw walk in our two radiation oncologists who give radiation therapy over here at Dana-Farber, and they'll use an external beam device. There are many other fancy terms for this. I don't understand all of the nuances being a urologist, but there's image-guided radiation therapy and 3D conformal radiation therapy. Suffice it to say, this is one of the most sophisticated treatments that we have in medicine because what it does is it tailors a treatment that's exactly for that man based on the shape of the prostate, the man's build, how much cancer they have, and it's given very, very discreetly and specifically to the prostate gland over a series of several weeks with really minimal side effects. Patients do very, very well with this type of treatment. It used to be that patients would have difficulty urinating, bowel problems, etc. We almost never see that now. We see very well-tolerated treatment with external radiation, and patients can go about their lives. If they're working, they can come before work or come after work to have their radiation. It takes about 15 or 20 minutes a day, Monday through Fridays. Why is it Monday through Friday? Well, you know, the weekends is football, right? So there's Monday through Friday, 8 or 9 weeks. And it's very well-tolerated, and patients have great results. But again, it has to be tailored to that individual patient's cancer grade, how much cancer they have, and also taking their lifestyle and other factors into effect. And if you have a lot of other medical conditions, this doesn't make you sick. It doesn't make your hair fall out. It doesn't make you lose weight. And there's a whole team of experts who are there to help you during this treatment. There's also prostate brachytherapy, or what we call radioactive seed implantation. And these are little grains of rice that are radioactive. They're implanted in the operating room. They're actually not rice, but they have radiation embedded titanium, like your golf clubs, that are implanted into the prostate, and they give off internal radiation over several weeks. And Dr. Oreo is actually one of the world experts in doing prostate brachytherapy. And he does this with a urologist. We do this as a joint procedure. But all of the heavy lifting is in the planning of this and in actually tailoring the treatment specifically for the man's prostate, the size, the shape, and where the cancer is. And it's a very, very sophisticated treatment that is among the best in the world right here in our ORs because we have this affiliation with Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. And this radiation is given off over several weeks. You don't have to go in every day, 15 minutes a day. It's done once. The only restriction is you can't have young kids sit on your lap for a few weeks because of the theoretical problem of them getting in contact with the radiation. Otherwise, you feel very well. You go home the same day as the procedure, and it's very, very effective for certain kinds of prostate cancer. And here's a picture of Dana-Farber. We're blessed to have it right here in our backyard. And there, we have a monthly conference between the urologist and the radiation oncologist and medical oncologist regarding what the best treatment is. So we approach this as a team approach. And now there's our other therapies. This one is cryotherapy, or freezing of the prostate, where similar to brachytherapy or radioactive seed implantation, put little rods in the prostate, and they create ice balls within the prostate. And this has two applications. One is when we find early prostate cancer, but also sometimes cancer will come back after external beam radiation therapy, and we can use this if you need additional treatment after external beam radiation therapy. And this is very, very effective. Again, has to be tailored to the specifics of a man's prostate cancer. Something new that I was recently trained in is what we call high-frequency ultrasound ablation. So everybody knows what ultrasound is, right? So ultrasound is, we use, like, pregnant women get ultrasounds to see the fetus. We use ultrasound to see the prostate. This isn't diagnostic ultrasound. This is very, very powerful ultrasound that is used to kill cancer. So this was approved a year ago in the United States. It's been used in Europe for many, many years, and the studies show that it's effective in certain types of cancer. And it's a one-shot deal, and the probe is put in through the rectum. And again, you remember we talked about the MRI images? We use the MRI images in real time with ultrasound, and we use ultrasound waves to kill the cancer. Now, the nice thing about this is that if there's a lot of prostate cancer, we can treat the whole prostate. If only half the prostate has cancer in it, we can decide to just treat the half of the prostate, or what we call hemiablation, or we might just do a certain region of the prostate, and this gentleman spoke about one biopsy core showing prostate cancer, and if that area lit up on MRI, that would be even easier to treat, again, with high-frequency ultrasound. So this has been around in the U.S. for 1 year. We're accruing data as to our outcomes in the United States. That's the good news. It's a new minimally invasive treatment. The bad news is it's not covered by any insurance yet. So we're waiting for Medicare and other insurers to approve this for payment. And that's the typical course. Something has to be around between 3 and 5 years used in the United States and with proven outcomes until Medicare and the other insurers will actually pay for this. But this is available at certain centers in the United States. And then there's da Vinci robotic surgery. So has anybody heard of the robot, da Vinci robot? So this has been around now for 12 years. I trained in it 11 years ago. And this is the world's most expensive video game. It's a $2 million system where the surgeon sits with his head in this three-dimensional video console. There's an assistant at the bedside putting instruments in through small incisions. And everything is in three dimensions, watching on a video screen Well, they use very small instruments to remove the prostate. So it used to be we made a big cut, a lot of blood lost, long hospitalization, long recovery, catheter in the penis for a long time. Now we do this with small incisions, minimal pain. Patients are typically in the hospital 1 or 2 nights. And if anybody has, many of you may have heard about this lecture because of this article that was in Good Feelings magazine. This is Ken White. Ken couldn't be here tonight, but he had da Vinci robotic surgery, and he tells his story in this magazine, a very active guy, and he was back to biking very shortly after his da Vinci robotic surgery. So that's a technology we've had here for a few years at Milford Regional Medical Center, and this is what we as urologists do. It's one of the treatments we do here, and it's good for cancers that are confined to the prostate, that are not going outside the prostate, and also for men where preservation of erections is very important. And the advantage to the da Vinci machine is that we can see these nerves that go next to the prostate and spare them. They're the nerves that go to the penis to control erections. They were very, very difficult or impossible to see in the old days with open surgery, but now, because the da Vinci device gives us high degree magnification in 3 dimensions, we can actually see the nerves through the video screen and spare them, dissect them off the prostate. These are the instruments. The instruments are tiny. They're put through small incisions. They're very precise, and they have much greater degree of freedom of movement than the human hand. So this has been in common use in the United States for over 10 years. The outcomes are good. The criticism is that the outcomes in terms of curing cancer may not be any better than open surgery was. The advantages are typically a shorter hospital stay, less blood loss, and less return to normal activities like going back to work or exercising, etc. But it's an expensive technology. Not every hospital can afford it. We do have it here, and myself, Dr. Kumar, and Dr. Mickley, the 3 urologists here who use the da Vinci technology, have a significant experience in doing these operations. So as I mentioned, compared to open prostatectomy, cancer control is about the same. Potency rates are about the same in terms of getting your erections back, but they tend to return a little bit earlier after surgery. The continence rates, or how much a man leaks, is about the same. Less blood loss, less pain meds, and a quicker return to work. So those are kind of the technologies. I'm going to talk a little bit about the conundrum and how we're trying to solve the conundrum of whether to look for prostate cancer and how we look for it, and then once we find it, of how aggressive to be. And this is a very busy slide, so I apologize for this, but I just want to point out a couple things. And one of the big recent aids in trying to decide whether to do a biopsy in a man is this 4K score. Now, this is a big box, and all it has is a little blood collection tube. That's all it has in it, but it's all about the packaging. This is a test that I perform in my office and many other urologists perform. We will draw a man's blood if the PSA is elevated, and we draw this blood and we send it to an outside lab that does the special test looking for 4 substances in the bloodstream that are felt to be associated with higher incidence of aggressive prostate cancer. And unlike PSA, which is typically 0 to 4, so you're in that range, this gives a prediction on a scale of 0 to 100 of having aggressive prostate cancer. So many men that I see in my practice will come in, they have an elevated PSA for their age, or it's rising. They know about the risks of a biopsy, maybe an infection, maybe bleeding, and they say, "Doc, isn't there something else we can do before we jump into a biopsy?" And this is typically what I'll order. It's covered by insurance. It's drawn in the office. We send it out by FedEx to the lab in Indianapolis, and I usually get a result within 1 week. 7.5 or lower on the score is considered a good result. That is, there's a low chance of having aggressive prostate cancer. And then over 7.5 is considered at higher risk, and there's different grades within it. But this has been a big help. So isn't there a better blood test? Yes. This blood test is not perfect, but it's another piece of evidence we can use to decide whether to perform a biopsy. And it's called the 4K score. And then there are other genetic score and genetic tests with once you have prostate cancer diagnosed to decide how aggressive to be, where your tissue from the biopsy is actually sent to a lab to do genomics or look at the DNA and other markers within the prostate tissue, and to give us a prediction on how aggressive the prostate cancer is, particularly in those medium categories. And I use this very commonly. Oncotype DX is the one I use the most. That's one test that is done on the tissue. It doesn't require another biopsy. We take the tissue from your old biopsy, we send it to the lab, and particularly in men who have grade 6, Gleason score of 6, or a score of 3 plus 4, which gives them a 7, we'll use this to determine whether we should do active surveillance or aggressive treatment. So these tests were not around a few years ago. Now they're very, very helpful in trying to determine what to do once you've been diagnosed with prostate cancer. And these are called genomic tests. So how do we, again, this is like being on Google, right? 2 million hits. What are we going to do? You might be more confused now than when than you were before you came in here, because there's so much information. And we can't even get the doctors to agree on what to do. So this is a little slide I put together to kind of compare the different treatments here. And I've kind of categorized them by the treatments we discussed, as including active surveillance, whether the tumor grade, what the tumor grade is, the health status, whether it's a patient's desire to preserve erections, and also preserve continence. So look at the first line, active surveillance. If your tumor grade is low, that is, I would say 3 plus 4, but with minimal disease, or grade 6, and good health status required, no. Anybody can do active surveillance. You don't have to be in good health. Preserve erections, well, active surveillance, no treatment, will probably preserve your erections and preserve continence. And active surveillance might be a good choice for men where this exists and these are priorities for them. Let's look at external radiation. External radiation can be used for all tumor grades. Good health status required, and Dr. Ori, Dr. Phillips, correct me if I'm wrong, but generally, even if patients have a lot of medical problems, they can tolerate external beam radiation fairly well. It's not a very strenuous type of treatment. Even if you have multiple medical issues, your prostate cancer can be treated, if it's appropriate to treat it, with external radiation. Preserve erections, perhaps. I say that perhaps because the studies differ. Preserve continence, yes. In general, continence is good after external radiation. Brachytherapy, or the little radioactive seeds, generally low-grade tumors. Again, we tend not to treat 8, 9, and 10, although Dr. Oreo has treated some very aggressive cancers, 8, 9, and 10, very successfully with a combination of treatments using brachytherapy and external radiation. Good health status required. Perhaps it still involves anesthesia and still involves about 2.5 hours for a complicated procedure under anesthesia. But it's not certainly not as stressful as having your prostate removed. So most men who are in reasonable health can undergo brachytherapy. Preserve erections, yes. Preserve continence, yes. And the results are excellent in terms of curing cancer. Cryotherapy and HIFU, low tumor grades. We're not treating aggressive cancers with those. Good health status required. Again, it's a fairly long procedure under anesthesia, so you have to be in decent health for that. Preserve erections, the word is still out on whether it preserves erections. Preserve continence. But one other category I didn't put here, that these two treatments, you can treat just part of the prostate, not the whole prostate. And that used to be the most common question I'd get. Well, doc, if only the left apex was involved with prostate cancer, why don't we just treat the left apex? And in the old days, I say, because you know what? I can't see your cancer. I don't know if we're treating it or not. But now with MRI and being able to see the lesion, we can target it using both cryo and HIFU in the appropriate cancers, can just treat that area. And then robotic surgery, tumor grade, yes, you can treat all cancers with robotic surgery. However, in very aggressive cancers, you might wind up needing radiation in addition to having your prostate removed. Good health status required, definitely, for robotic surgery. So you're tipped on your head for 3 hours. It's a very strenuous operation to undergo, and you really have to be in good health to undergo that operation. If you're on blood thinners, that can be a problem. If you have heart disease or breathing problems, that can be a problem. So robotic surgery is meant for men in very good health otherwise. Good health status required. And then preserve erections, perhaps. So what is the rate of preserving erections in experienced hands? If both nerves are preserved, it's about 75%. If only one nerve is preserved, it goes down to about 50%. Preserve continence, perhaps. Preserve continence. And what is continence? Needing one pad or less in your underwear per day. Most patients do well with doing Kegel exercises, to like women do after they have babies, to get their continence back. So most patients recover their continence fairly quickly after surgery if they have good continence beforehand. So how do we decide? Because there's so much information, how do we really decide, now what should I do? Getting back to the original question. Well, we have to look at the grade of the cancer, the stage, how much cancer is there, the patient's age, the overall health. I could have a 60-year-old who comes in and they have so many medical conditions, I would never consider treating them with an invasive treatment. I could have a 75-year-old gentleman in who plays tennis every day and plays golf every day and they're on no medications. So their overall health is really important in determining how aggressive to be. Their sexual function, the urinary function, and then here's a really important part that you won't find in any studies. A lot of the outcome of treatment for prostate cancer depends upon your attitude, your overall approach to your disease, and the relationship that you have with your treating physicians. So it's been shown that you have a positive relationship and confidence in your treatment, you're actually going to do better with your treatment. So you have to have that rapport and the confidence that you've had shared decision making, you've gone through all the evidence, and that you're making the right decision. And it's a process. So what I tell patients after they're first diagnosed with prostate cancer is, this is not an emergency, but it is usually to the wife or significant other. Got to do something today. No, we're gonna start the learning process about all of the options for prostate cancer. And if you told me tomorrow that you wanted surgery, I wouldn't do it, because you're just starting the learning process about prostate cancer. And I encourage you to get other opinions. I encourage you to see my colleagues in radiation oncology. I encourage you to see other folks to answer your questions. And if they agree with my recommendations, that just reinforces that we're on the same wavelength. If they disagree, then usually I learn something about their recommendations. So this is a process, and a process with multiple opinions, multiple options, but at the end of the day, it's what's right for that gentleman and his family. So the confidence and relationship is critical when we're finally making the decision for treatment for prostate cancer. So I'm just going to put up my contact information. I'm around the corner here in Hopedale, and prostate cancer is one of the fields I work on. Men's health are my other areas, as well as kidney stones and other types of cancers. But I want to, as a take-home point, to let you know that prostate cancer is, number one, not a death sentence. More men will die with prostate cancer than of prostate cancer. And then once it is diagnosed, it doesn't have to be aggressively treated if it's a favorable cancer, meaning low grade, low volume, low stage cancer. And if you do decide to treat it, it's a process of learning and getting multiple opinions and then going forward in a coordinated fashion. I think that's one of the advantages of coming here, because we have the Dana-Farber Brigham and Women's Cancer Center working with the urologists, of us jointly agreeing how to proceed with treatment for prostate cancer. If folks would like to see a short video about the MRI ultrasound fusion biopsy, we can play that. Okay. So this is the MRI ultrasound fusion biopsy technique. It's a company called Coelus. So the putting on the they're going to go through it a little more slowly. So it's three-dimensional because we're using MRI images, fusing it with ultrasound. So here the physicians are looking at the MRI that was done previously, and then the MRI is actually loaded into this workstation. It looks like a portable computer console, and it is used to coordinate in real time with ultrasound where to perform the biopsies. And again, this is a technique when biopsies have been performed but are negative, but there's still a high suspicion of having prostate cancer because it doesn't show up just on the ultrasound images. So basically what they're doing here is this is the ultrasound of the prostate. This is ultrasound, and the transducer is being put in to the rectum, and there's a little guide there for the needle, and this is as the physician turns the ultrasound, he can see it in different directions. Then they'll mark out the area of the ultrasound that correlates with the MRI to decide where to do the biopsies. And you can see here that they've marked certain areas, those yellow areas, as being high suspicion areas. This is a biopsy gun that is used. And this may be done under sedation or under general anesthesia. It's a little bit longer than a normal biopsy, so typically patients will need a little Valium or sometimes sedative like in colonoscopy to do this. So here, they've demarcated these areas on the MRI that correlate with the ultrasound, and they can track in real time where the needle is going to go to make sure they hit those areas. So it's a big advantage over the old type of biopsy done under ultrasound guidance only. And then you can actually go back and see whether you've hit the areas that you were targeting. You can't do that with ultrasound. Ultrasound is here and now. It is not dynamic. It basically only shows where you're pointing the needle. The MRI can go and show you whether you've hit it or not. Those little red lines show where the biopsy cores went to mark that you've actually hit the region of interest. You can go backwards and see and make sure that you've hit it. I again want to thank Donna and the marketing department here at Milford Regional Medical Center, my colleagues Dr. Oreo and Dr. Phillips, Tom McMahon from Urolays, for helping put together the production. And please help yourself to some of the materials. And I hope everybody has a wonderful and healthy Thanksgiving and holiday season. So thank you for coming.